Good morning, everyone. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Riya Sethi. It is a pleasure to have you all here to our webinar on refreshers on foreign direct investment law. To take you through this topic, we have with us our three panelists, Mrs. Aarti Narsana. She is an off counsel at Vaish Associates, Mumbai. Mr. Krishna Kishore, he's an associate partner at Vaish Associates, Mumbai office. And Mr. Alok Sharma, he's a principal associate at Vaish Associates, Mumbai office. They're all a part of our corporate team. Each of them have worked on cross-border transactions. Now, before moving on with the webinar, I would like you all to know that all the attendees are on mute, and therefore request everyone that in case of any questions for the panelists, please post them in the question box, which has been provided in the control panel. Moreover, everything discussed in this webinar is only for your information purposes and the personal view of the panelists, and nothing should be taken as legal advice. Lastly, the webinar will be posted on the YouTube channel of Vaish Associates Advocates. Now, I would like to start the presentation with Aarti. Ms. Aarti.
Good evening, everyone. Very warm welcome to the presentation on foreign investment laws in the country. There has been a sea change of the foreign direct investment regime recently starting October, and hence we thought it would be good to have a webinar where we can update everyone with the slew of amendments that have happened recently. As we all might know that foreign investment is governed under the principal legislation, Foreign Exchange Management Act. Under the Act, there are foreign exchange management non-debt investment rules established in 2019. Then we have foreign exchange management mode of payment and reporting regulations. RBI had earlier issued master directions, but in the new regime, all powers relating to regulation of non-debt instruments have been vested with central government. And therefore, the RBI master directions, it's not clear if they are valid. The reason is that the main legislation under which the master directions have been issued itself have been repealed. And then master circulars have already been withdrawn by RBI. The FDI policy, it was last updated in August 2017, and thereafter it has not been updated, does not incorporate the amendments made through the NDI rules. So we don't know whether the FDI policy also, to what extent it holds validity. And last but not the least, we have press notes. So as on date, the law that we have on foreign investment is Foreign Managed Investment Act, Foreign Exchange Management Act, the non-debt instrument rules, the mode of payment and reporting of non-debt instrument regulations, and press notes. Other things seem to be archaic. So the main shift from before the non-debt rules, we had transfer or issue of securities by a person resident outside India regulation known as TISPRO. In October 2019, this TISPRO regulations were repealed, and a totally new set of rules was introduced known as non-debt instrument rules. And the main thing is, whilst the foreign investment related provisions in TISPRO and NDI rules are similar, the main difference is TISPRO was a legislation issued by the Reserve Bank of India, whereas the NDI rules is a legislation issued by the central government. And RBI has only issued the mode of payment and reporting regulations. So the scope or the authority of the regulators have changed. This is a key change. Then all the debt-related instruments are still within the domain of RBI. Apart from that, even the immovable property, which was earlier governed under a separate legislation, has now been clubbed under the non-debt instrument regulation. So non-debt instrument rules are much more broader in scope than the erstwhile TISPRO regulations. Also, whilst central government is the main legislative authority under the NDI rules, if approvals are required under any save for approvals relating to sectoral policy for which the authority is the relevant government department. The other approvals, the application has to still be made to the RBI, but RBI has to decide the application in consultation with central government, and it cannot decide the application on its own, except maybe when it relates to mode of payment and reporting. Now, main shift from TISPRO to NDI rules, the key changes, the entire legislative framework has been divided into two buckets, the debt bucket and the equity bucket. The debt bucket, there is a separate set of rules, non-debt instrument rules, which is in the scope of RBI, whereas the equity instruments is totally now under the scope of the non-debt instrument rules. And the non-debt instrument is not limited just to equity shares and CCDs, etc., but also includes investments in LLPs, any other form of investment instruments recognized by government, units of AIFs, investment trust, units of mutual funds if more than 50% of such funds investment is in equity, junior most layer of securitization tranche, dealings in immovable property, etc. So the scope of non-debt is much wider than just equity instruments or capital instruments. We'll just have a quick look at the main concepts in the foreign investment regime. So what is foreign investment? Any investment from a person resident outside India on a repatriable basis in equity instruments of an Indian company or a LLP. So the main point is it has to be on repatriable basis. All the investments done by NRIs or overseas citizens of India from their domestic funds are on non-repatriation basis and they are not foreign investment. And any laws and regulation regarding foreign investments generally then do not apply to such investments on non-repatriation basis. Foreign direct investment is defined as any investment in an unlisted company or 10% more of investment in a listed company. And portfolio investment is a complement to the foreign direct investment, which is any investment of less than 10% in a listed company. There is no concept of portfolio investment in an unlisted company. There cannot, by definition, be any portfolio investment in an unlisted company. Here also, there is some complication or anomaly which is there and I would like to bring out. So the listed company is defined in the NDI rules as a company of which equity or debt is listed. Now, if there is a situation where company has only listed its debt instruments and not listed its equity, and an investor wants to acquire, say, 5% of equity of such a company, then it falls into a regulatory gray whether that 5% will be treated as portfolio investment because this is a listed company because its debt is listed, or whether such investment cannot be done at all because this is in essence an unlisted company and the investment is less than 10%. Now there are three entry routes available for foreign investment. One is automatic route, the other is government approval route, and last is the foreign portfolio investment route. And for automatic and approval, it is very clearly laid out in Schedule 1. The sectoral policy, the investment related conditions, and the transfer or ownership of control in case of automatic and government approval route is permitted subject to the sectoral policy. If sectoral policy allows, non-resident can acquire control also. Whereas in the foreign portfolio investment regime, the sectoral cap or statutory cap, whichever is lower, is the applicable cap. You don't have to comply with performance linked conditions. So to receive foreign direct investment, say in wholesale trading, the company can receive it only if it complies with the wholesale trading related regulations. But for a foreign portfolio investor, that investor can invest less than 10% in the company, if such a company is listed company, without even satisfying the performance linked conditions, even if such company is under the government approval route. But foreign portfolio investment can be made up to less than 10% by without seeking the government approval. The main thing is investment should not result in transfer of ownership or control to the person resident outside India. The NDI rules have 10 schedules, and each of the schedule deals with a particular type of investor or a particular category of investing entity. And therefore, whenever an investment transaction is evaluated, it is best to figure out where your transaction falls to determine the right regulatory regime. So for person resident outside India, Schedule 1, it is relating to all types of investment which need to comply with sectoral policy. Foreign portfolio investors, their investment regime is decided in Schedule 2. For NRIs and OCIs, there is Schedule 3. And for their investments on non-repatriation basis, there is Schedule 4. For LLPs, there is Schedule 6. The main thing to invest in LLPs is that FPI and FVCI cannot invest in LLPs. Citizens of Pakistan and Bangladesh are not permitted to invest in LLPs. Only sectors where 100% FDI is permitted without any performance linked conditions, LLP can accept investments only in those sectors. So if there is a LLP in, say, a pharmaceutical sector, for brownfield pharmaceutical, where there is a FDI cap of 74%, beyond which it needs government approval, maybe it may not be permitted to receive foreign investment. So similarly, there are schedules relating to FVCI and for other investments other than equity investments. Whilst we are discussing the investment regime, I would like to point out that for foreign portfolio investor, as I already pointed out, their maximum shareholding in each company in each series should be less than 10%. Recently, in the amendments in this NDI rules, the government has specified that FPI investment can go up to the sectoral limit. And the companies were given an option before 31st March 2020 to reduce that. And if they have not reduced it before 2020, now they cannot reduce it. And the limit is automatically now the sectoral cap. In this regard, we had received a query from one of the attendees in advance of the webinar as to, can, although the 31st March 2020 deadline has expired, can the company now reduce the FPI investment limit? From our perspective, the way the legislation is drafted, the company cannot now reduce the FPI investment limit as the NDI rules do not provide for the same. However, at the same time, the way the rule is drafted, it ensures, or it is making it irreversible. The FPI investment limit is irreversible. And from our perspective, if there is not outstanding FPI investment in the company, there should be no reason why a company cannot change the limit in perpetuity. There should be at least some interval, annually, quarterly, where company can review or revisit its decision. So in our view, maybe a consultation or a permission from the RBI through the authorized dealer could be taken, or this could be brought to the notice of the authority so that a more rational resolution can be there for this challenge. Now the NDI rules, we have also seen a series of game-changing amendments. One such amendment was on 27th April 2020, dealing with changes in the pricing mechanism of renunciation of rights shares. Prior to the amendment, rights issue can be made by a company at any price as long as the price offered to resident investor and non-resident investor is same. Using this mechanism, many companies used to bypass the valuation norms and bypass the stringent preferential allotment compliance procedure and do a rights issue where all the other shareholders would renounce the rights in favor of a non-resident. The loophole has now been plugged, And now it is said that if a resident Indian renounces its rights in favor of a non-resident, then such non-resident can acquire shares only as per the compliance of pricing guidelines, which for an unlisted company means it has to be fair value certified by a CA or a merchant banker. Interestingly, for a listed company, although the same rules apply, but under the SEBI guidelines, a listed company is free to determine the price of its rights issue in consultation with the lead merchant banker. And the SEBI regulations do not have any special regime for determination of price for a renunciation part of the issue. So in our view, unless a contrary instruction comes from the regulator, a listed company may not see much impact of this change and they may still be able to comply with the renunciation. In the renunciation process also, as non-repatriation basis shares are not treated as foreign investment, the restrictions on renunciation pricing will not apply to investments on non-repatriation basis. However, it is not clear whether if rights is renounced by one non-resident in favor of another, will it still have to meet the fair value principle, or is it only when it is renounced from a resident to a non-resident? Another question is, what happens when a foreign-owned and controlled company rights are renounced in favor of such FOCC from another FOCC or a resident or a non-resident? What is the regulatory response? That is also unclear. So we hope that these clarifications are answered by the regulator soon. Another smaller amendments are like the definition of SBRT, the commencement of business. It was already liberalized in Press Note 4 of 2019, but was missed out in the NDI rule. So it has been reincorporated and clarified that the 3 years is from the start of first online store or retail store, whichever is earlier. For divestment by FPI, if investment by FPI results in breach of the investment limits, the additional rule that has been added is it will be subject to additional conditions specified by SEBI or RBI, but as on date, no conditions have been specified by SEBI or RBI. Another liberalization is 100% foreign investment under automatic route is now allowed in insurance intermediaries. The conditions for foreign investments have also been specified, which is at least one chairman or CEO or managing director should be a resident Indian citizen. IRDA permission is needed for repatriation of dividends. Latest technology, managerial and other skills should be brought into as a part of investments, etc. Now, and the approval route. So I would like to summarize what are the present requirements or for the approval route. So one is approval is needed where specified under the sectoral policy. Two, core investment company, foreign investment in a core investment company still needs government approval. Investing companies not registered with RBI as NBFC needs government approval. And last but most important is investment from bordering country as amended recently by Press Note 3. This is one game-changing amendment which has come and could severely impact not only the new investments but also the past investments. And I will request my colleague Krishna Kishore to take you through in detail the amendments of Press Note 3. Over to you, Krishna.
Thank you, Aarti. Good evening, everybody. I will be taking you through about the amendment brought by Press Note 3 of 2020. So this amendment was brought last month, April 17, 2020, primarily to curb the opportunistic takeover or acquisitions of Indian companies due to the current COVID-19 pandemic. The background of this amendment was there was a shareholding pattern disclosures of HDFC Limited, which was done, where it was noticed that the People's Bank of China had increased its holding into HDFC from 0.8% to 1.01% through open market purchases. But the investment which was done, it was done as a foreign portfolio investment, as an FPI. So if you see the amendment, it also contemplates about investments from the bordering country will be subject to government. Now, if there is a bordering country involved, and the objective is you want to curb the opportunistic takeover, why only bordering countries and not any other? So essentially, this amendment is to check about the investments from Chinese entities. And this amendment is not only relating to foreign investment done by the only India, but there are many other countries across the globe which have also adopted similar approach about checking about the foreign investments. Now, prior to the amendment, what was the legal position? So prior to the amendment, the foreign direct investment from the citizen of Bangladesh or Pakistan or any entity which was incorporated in these countries was subject to approval. Now, as per the recent amendment, that is pursuant to the press note 3 read with the amendment carried out in NDI rules, an entity of a country which shares the land border with India or where the beneficial owner of an investment is situated in or is a citizen of any of the bordering country, they can only invest with the prior approval of government, regardless of the sectors or activities in which the investments is intended to be made. Also, citizens or entity from Pakistan cannot in any case invest in sensitive areas like defense, space, and atomic energy. Further, the amendment also contemplates that any subsequent change in the beneficial ownership by way of a transfer of ownership directly or indirectly, if the beneficial ownership moves to an entity that is of a bordering country or whose beneficial owner is situated in or is a citizen of any of the bordering country, then you have to approach the government for their approval. Consequent to this amendment, this will have a larger ramification in case of global mergers and acquisitions where any of the investor is from the bordering country. And in cases, the target company has a subsidiary or a joint venture in India, because the amendment also contemplates about indirect investments into India. Going forward, we can see greater amount of scrutiny from the authorized dealer with respect to the foreign investments, asking for more details whether any investor is from any of those bordering countries or not. Now, which are the countries from where the investments would be restricted or for which government approval is required in the institute? There are altogether 7 countries: Pakistan, Afghanistan, China, Nepal, Bhutan, Myanmar, and Bangladesh. Now, there is a lot of controversy around whether Hong Kong investment from Hong Kong would be covered under the government approval route or not. Hong Kong does not actually share its land border with India. It is a special administrative region of People's Republic of China. And as per the data which is published by the TIIT on its website relating to the foreign investments, the investment from Hong Kong and China both are reflected separately and not together. Also, India has a separate DTA with China and Hong Kong. So it's unclear as of now, going forward, if the investments from Hong Kong will be subject to government approval or not. Now, what is the effective date of this amendment? This amendment has come into effect from April 2020. After this amendment, when you read this, there is no guidance which is provided as to what will happen to the current status of committed deals where the parties would have signed a binding agreement or binding term sheets and the closing is yet to be consummated. In such cases, since there is no clarity provided in the amendment, government approval could be required. Also, in cases where the company would have received the share application money and the shares have not been allotted on the date of notification for the allotment of shares, approval of government would be required in such cases. Similarly, in case of transfer of shares, if the transferee has already transferred the money to the transferor and the transfer is still pending, in such cases, approval would be required prior to consummating the transfer. Now, the concept of beneficial ownership, because the amendment contemplates about change in beneficial ownership or if the beneficial ownership is situated in or is a citizen of any of those foreign countries. So the term beneficial ownership has not been defined in the press note 3 or in FEMA or its any related regulations or NDI rules. However, the explanation to the definition of foreign investments in NDI rules provide that if a declaration is made by a person as per the provisions of the Companies Act about a beneficial interest being held by a person resident outside India, then such investment is considered as a foreign investment. It will not be considered as a domestic investment. Section 89 of the Companies Act deal with the declarations which are required to be made by the legal owner and the beneficial owner to the reporting company, and consequently company is required to make file those forms with the registrar of companies. Now, what is the concept of beneficial interest has been defined under subsection 10 of section 89 of the Companies Act, which provides that in case beneficial interest in a share includes directly or indirectly through contract, arrangement or otherwise, whereby any person exercise or pause to exercise any all of the rights attached to such shares or receives or participate in any dividend or distribution in respect of such shares. Section 89 is generally applicable in cases where the shares are held by an entity or an individual as a nominee for the purpose of having minimum shareholders requirement, or in cases of a joint venture where one of the joint venture partner or the joint venture partner decides to have a nominee shareholder for the purpose of having quorum requirements at the shareholders meeting. Beneficial ownership has also been defined under the PMLA rules, and the term significant beneficial owner has been defined under the SBO rules framed under the Companies Act. Both SBO rules and the PMLA rules have a different threshold for the determination of beneficial ownership in case of companies. Now, what is SBO? SBO in relation to an Indian company means an individual who acting alone or together through one or more persons or trust has following rights that indirectly or together with any direct holdings, 10% or more of the shares, 10% or more of the voting rights in shares, 10% or more of or entitlement or to receive 10% or more of the distributed dividend, or having a right to exercise significant influence or control. Now, what is a direct shareholding or a direct shareholding which will be determined for the purpose of SBO? It will be applicable in cases where the shares are held in the name of an individual directly, or where the beneficial owner has filed a beneficial interest under Section 89, which discussed earlier also. And what do we mean by indirect shareholding? We will show you in the next slide as how it has to be dealt. So SBO in relation to a member, it's depend on the nature of member, whether it is a body corporate, it's a LLP, it's a trust or HUF or a pooled investment vehicle. Over here, we will be discussing about a body corporate. In case of a body corporate, whether incorporated in India or outside India, an SBO would be an individual who holds a majority stake in that member or who holds a majority stake in the ultimate holding company. Now, for illustration purposes, there is a diagram if you can see on your screen. There is an Indian company having three investors. Investor one, which is a foreign body corporate. Investor two and three, they are Indian citizens. Now, if we have to check the SBO, who is the SBO to the extent of 30% of investment by investor one? In this case, we have to see the individual who is holding more than 51%, which is a foreign national situated in USA. So the foreign individual in USA will be considered as a SBO to the extent of 30% being held in the Indian company. Now, beneficial ownership, as we discussed earlier, is also defined under the PMLA rules. So in case of a company, the beneficial owner is the natural person who acting alone or together has a controlling ownership interest or who exercises control. Now, these two terms, controlling ownership interest and control, both are defined under the PMLA rules. Controlling ownership interest means ownership or entitlement to more than 25% of the shares of the share or capital or profits of the company. So essentially, if you can block a special resolution, it implies that you are having a controlling ownership interest. Now, coming to control. Control is a right to appoint the majority of the directors or to control the management or to take policy decisions by virtue of shareholding or management rights. In case where there are no natural person who can be identified as the beneficial ownership in the case of a company, then the beneficial owner is the relevant natural person who holds the position of a senior managing officer of that company. Now, what happens to the investments in LLP? As Aarti mentioned to you, foreign investments in LLP are permitted up to 100% under automatic rule, provided the LLPs are engaged in activities or sectors in which FDI is allowed under 100% automatic rule, and there are no FDI linked performance its conditions. Accordingly, any investments from the borrowing country henceforth may imply that they may not be able to receive foreign investments from the borrowing country. So maybe a clarification from government will have to be sought whether existing LLPs would be able to receive investment from their parent entity, as there are no issues relating to opportunistic takeovers and acquisitions in such cases. Now, there are a host of issues on which clarification will be required from the government or RBI. What is the definition of beneficial ownership? Whether it has to be applicable as per the PMLA rules, SBO rules, or there has to be a new criteria which will be defined by the government. What is the meaning of the term situated in? Because if you have read the regulation, it contemplates about the beneficial owner is situated in or is a citizen of a bordering country. So clarification in this regard would be required, whether it is basis the number of days of residency, permanent residency. So clarification is awaited on those for that term. What happens to the convertible instruments which have already been issued and which are pending conversion? Will approval required in such cases? Because once you have received the FDI, you would have done the necessary filing with the RBI about those investments. It's just the investments are pending to be investments are supposed to be converted into shares now. So whether in those cases approval are required or not. Now, what happens to the investments in AIF, RITs, InvITs, ADRs, and GDRs? Only on subsidiaries, because these are the companies closely held, and any investments from the bordering country does not actually, there is no opportunistic takeovers or acquisitions. So whether in these cases approvals are required or not, maybe some exemptions will have to be granted by the government for these kinds of companies. Whether approval is required in case of bonus issues, rights issues, warrants on existing investment. Is PRESNO 3 applicable even to issue of ESOPs for employees who are citizens of bordering country? And what happens in cases where the employees who have already received options, when they exercise options in future, would they require to require government approval for such when they exercise the options? Whether approval is required in case of invocation of already pledged shares if the lender is from the borrowing country? In future, if there is a creation of pledge and the lender is from the borrowing country, do we need approval at that point of time or at the time of invocation of the pledge? Whether approval is required in case of issuance of equity shares to an entity or a citizen of the bordering country pursuant to a scheme of amalgamation. Will PRESNO 3 apply if the ultimate beneficiary is not from the bordering country but has routed investments through bordering country just for the tax purposes? Now, we will try to do some case studies to check whether in these cases PRESNO 3 triggers or not, or approval from government is required or not. There is a foreign body corporate situated in Mauritius, which is holding 51% stake in the Indian Target. Proposed to acquire 51% stake into the Indian Target. And the shareholding pattern of the foreign body corporate is there are two investors, investor one and investor two, and there is a third investor who is situated in the bordering country holding 40%. So now two questions come. The beneficial ownership threshold has to be tested at the Indian level, the investee company, or it has to be tested at the investor level. So if you read the wording of the regulation, it says the beneficial ownership of the investment. So as the investment is being made by the foreign body corporate, in this case, into the Indian Target, one will have to look at the beneficial ownership at the foreign body corporate level, that is FBC level. And in this case, if you see the shareholding pattern, one of the investors is situated in the bordering country, and the threshold, assuming for the PMLA perspective, if you see, then the approval would be required for the proposed investment by FPC into the Target. Now, there is a case two pertaining to an offshore merger and offshore transfer, which is one of the game changer in this case. For any global acquisitions, whether approvals would be required if indirectly any of the Indian entity, one of the Target, has an investments into India. So in this case, there is FPC one having investments in Target one and Target two indirectly through FPC two and FPC three. Now FPC two and FPC three is proposed to be merged, and pursuant to the merger, shares are intended to be issued by Target 1 and Target 2 to the merger. Subsequent to the merger, Investor 2 proposes to transfer to Investor 4. So in this case, firstly, we'll have to check, we have to examine whether the issue of shares by Target 1 and Target 2 post the merger of a foreign company will necessitate approval from government or not. And secondly, once the share transfer happen at the FBC 1 level by Investor 2 and Investor 3, whether approval is required or not. Now, going to an offshore merger, shares will be issued to non-resident entity, which will trigger provisions of FEMA. And one will have to check the beneficial ownership of the merge code. In this case, if you see the ultimate beneficial ownership prior to the transfer, there is an Investor 3 situated in bordering country holding 30%. So accordingly, approval of government may be required in this case. Now coming to the second situation, where the shares are proposed to be transferred by Investor 2 to Investor 4, in this case, there is no change of shareholding happening at the Indian level, but the press note 3 also contemplate about indirect transfer of shares. So in this case, since pursuant to the transfer, the Investor 4 is situated in bordering country, approval of government would be required for the proposed transfer from Investor 2 to Investor 3. Now coming to another case, case B, which deals with the downstream investments in case of a foreign owned and controlled company. There is a FPC, body corporate situated outside India, and it has three investors, Investor 1, Investor 2, and Investor 3. Investor 3 is holding 60% and is situated in the bordering country. Now the Target 1, which is a subsidiary of FPC 1, proposes to acquire 70% stake into the Target 2. So now in this case, whether approval of government would be required or considering the structure, since the ultimate beneficial ownership in this company FPC at the investor level, if you see, is situated in a bordering country, approval may be required, because any acquisition by Target 1 into Target 2 will be considered as a downstream investment since it's a foreign owned and controlled company. Thank you. Any questions which are there, you can continue to post into the control panel relating to Q&A, which we will be taking at the last. Over to Ashish now.
Thank you, Krishna. So now the key changes, the many other changes have been happened, and the most recent amendment has happened in the NDI rules. The oldest amendments has happened on 5th December. Through the 5th December, no major game-changing amendments were made. Rather, certain errors were fixed, like the the liberalization in coal mining policy had already happened, but it was not incorporated in the NDI rules. Foreign investment in single brand retail was already liberalized in 2018, but NDI rules for some reason incorporated a position before liberalization. These errors were fixed. The entry mutual funds which invest more than 50% in equity instruments was removed from the definition of investment vehicle. However, it is still covered in instruments, non-debt instruments, so it's not a significant change. It could still be invested as a non-debt instrument. Also, an express clarification was added regarding pricing of convertibles, that it needs to be determined upfront, which was always the position. The pricing or formula has to be determined upfront, which was in any case always the position prior to the amendment. Now we will see. The equity instruments, like what are the equity instruments? Fully paid or partly paid shares, compulsorily, mandatorily, and fully convertible debentures and preference shares, and share warrants. And for equity shares in which are partly paid, the time period for full payment is 12 months and 25% amount has to be paid upfront. For share warrants also, 25% has to be paid upfront, and the maximum conversion duration is 18 months. Now, interesting thing is, prior to the NDI rules, RBI master direction permitted a relaxation in this time period of 12 months for issue of partly paid shares, if a monitoring agency was appointed in accordance with ICDR rules and the issue size exceeded 500 crores. Now, this condition has not been incorporated in the NDI rules, and the master directions are issued under the erstwhile DISPRO. So the question remains whether this relaxation is still available, and RBI should issue maybe more updated master directions or revised directions to ensure that there is no confusion. Another such situation has occurred in issue of instruments for consideration other than cash. So prior to the NDI framework also, non-cash consideration was permitted for issue of shares when it considered pre-incorporation expenses, swap of shares, purchase of imported machinery, etc. Now, for pre-incorporation expenses in case of a wholly owned subsidiary, it can be issued if 100% foreign investment is allowed under automatic route. There is no performance linked condition. There is a cap that such shares could be 5% of authorized capital or 500,000 USD, whichever is less, and it has to be reported within 30 days of issue and maximum from 1 year of incorporation. Now, earlier the master direction incorporated certain procedural and reporting related instructions which have not now been incorporated expressly in the NDI rules or the RBI's reporting regulations. However, from a practical perspective, the authorized dealers may still have to follow the same to comply with the framework till proper directions are issued by the RBI. Also, an Indian company may issue equity instruments against swap of equity instruments or import of capital goods. Now, here again in the next clause, we find a repeat entry, pre-operative and pre-incorporation expenses. Now, so in NDI rules, the first rule we just saw dealt with pre-incorporation expenses in relation to a wholly owned subsidiary. The next rule deals with pre-incorporation expenses. This is not limited to a wholly owned subsidiary. This does not have restrictive conditions such as a cap of 5% of capital or USD 500,000, or that the company should be in automatic route, etc. So possibly the regulations have incorporated the older version and the updated version and created a conflict. And it's better if the regulators go through the schedule and weed out the old entries, because this is a more liberal regime where pre-operative expenses can be capitalized by issue of shares without any limit, without any additional restrictive conditions. And there is no reason why a wholly owned subsidiary should have a more restrictive regime and other people should not have. Another conflict is that the RBI master directions use the word excluding partly paid shares in context of issue of equity instruments for consideration other than cash. So prior to the NDI rules, partly paid shares could not be issued for consideration other than cash. Now, this was contained in RBI directions, which have not been updated and have not been incorporated in the NDI rules. So therefore, it is unclear whether partly paid shares can now be issued for consideration other than cash. So it's better if, again, a clarification is issued by the RBI or the government on this. Again, there was one major liberalization which said Indian company may issue equity shares against any funds payable to it by a person resident outside India, the remittance of which is permitted under FEMA or rules made thereunder. Now, the NDI rules in the earlier situations use the word equity instrument, that a company may issue equity instruments, which means all convertible instruments as well. Whereas in this rule, they use the word equity shares, which seems to be a drafting error, because to us, there is no reason why in a particular situation only equity shares should be issued and not compulsorily convertible debentures or compulsorily convertible preference shares or warrants. So this is one anomaly the regulator should consider resolving. Another concern is that while it is clear that non-cash consideration is possible for shared issuance. However, it is not expressly permitted for share transfer. So that is one possible liberalization that should happen, where even transfers could be permitted for such a situation. Again, for non-cash consideration, the RBI master direction contains certain procedural systems which are now not incorporated in the NDI rules or in the reporting regulations. So maybe RBI should issue a comprehensive document clarifying its policies. For swap, the position is same, that if shares are swapped, valuation of merchant banker or an investment banker registered outside India is needed. For swap, also overseas direct investment regulations need to be considered. Another debate which has always been there and has not been resolved even when there has been a tremendous change in the regulations is whether swap is only permitted for fresh issue or even for transfer of shares. Downstream investment. This is one very important and complicated regulatory route for foreign investment in India. Downstream investment is a preferred structuring option for investment in sectors where foreign investment is restricted or prohibited. Through downstream investments, foreign investors can enjoy indirect investment benefits in sectors such as multi-brand, retail, gaming, etc. Company making downstream investment should not be a foreign owned and controlled company to benefit from the above. If a foreign owned and controlled company makes downstream investment, then it has to comply with entry rules, sectoral policy, pricing guidelines, and other foreign investment related conditions. What is a foreign owned and controlled company? Foreign owned and controlled company is a company incorporated in India, and more than 50% of equity of such companies owned by persons resident outside India, or such companies controlled by persons resident outside India. And control means right to appoint majority of directors or to control management or policy decisions. And in case of LLP, control means right to appoint majority of designated partners, where such designated partners with specific exclusion to others have control over policies of LLP. Now, how is downstream investment computed? So here we are considering three scenarios. The offshore company in scenario one has made 49% in an intermediate investment in a company X. X has further made downstream investment of 75%. Because the foreign investment in X is only 49%, being less than 50%, foreign investment in Y is zero, and Y could operate in any of the sectors where foreign investment is prohibited, regulated, or requires government approval. And the foreign shareholding of 49% indirect foreign shareholding will not be considered. Now, in the second diagram, the offshore company owns 51% in Indian company P, which in turn owns 75% in Q. Now, here, because the Indian company has majority foreign ownership, it is owned and controlled by persons resident outside India, and the entire 75% is treated as foreign investment, which means this company cannot have any investments. Q cannot make investments in sector where there is a sectoral cap which restricts the foreign investment at less than 75%. The third scenario is a scenario of a wholly owned subsidiary. So here the offshore company owns 51% in an Indian company. This Indian company has a wholly owned subsidiary X. Here the foreign investment in X is treated as 51% and not 100%. Accordingly, A can make any downstream investments in any companies so long as it complies with the foreign investment policy and the sectoral cap permits investments up to 51%. In making indirect investment, for foreign portfolio investments, 31st March of a previous year is considered as a cutoff for computing the total foreign investment. So even if on 31st March, the FPI investment is at 30%. Next day, it will drop to 10%. Nevertheless, for computation of downstream, what was there on 31st March will only be considered. Again, the entire downstream investment by an investment vehicle in a company will be treated as foreign investment if the sponsor or manager of investment vehicle is not owned and not controlled by resident Indian citizens or is owned and controlled by persons resident outside India. Funding of downstream investments. So downstream investments can do internal approval. It will be funded through borrowings from Indian market. The foreign owned controlled company has to bring in funds from abroad. That means it needs to do a fresh equity issuance or show that the money came from equity instruments from abroad. And the subscription by persons resident outside India to debentures of such FOCC, that funds can also be used for the downstream investment. Now, the compliance of downstream investment is complicated and cumbersome. Firstly, the board of investing company should approve of downstream investment. We will see in the next slide how at times a company may not even be aware that it is receiving downstream investment, and therefore this compliance may not be possible. The first level company making downstream investment shall be responsible for ensuring compliance with these rules for downstream investment made at second level, and so on and so forth. Such first level company should obtain a certificate to this effect from its statutory auditor, and if the auditor gives a qualified report, it should immediately report this to the Reserve Bank of India. So here we have made a diagram. In the diagram, this is a company Z, and here is the shareholding pattern of Z on December 1, 2019. On December 1, 2019, Z has P, which is an Indian owned and controlled company. P owns 45%. Z has R, which is a foreign owned and controlled company, which owns 5%. Q is a resident Indian, and A is an Indian owned and controlled company, 49% non-resident shareholders. Now on 1st March, P, there is a change in shareholding of P, and P becomes a foreign owned and controlled company. And also there is a FPI investment which increases in A. So on 1st March, no change in shareholding has happened at Z. The change in shareholding has happened at P, and as a result, because P owns 45%, which is an FOCC now, R owns 45%, which is an FOCC, R owns 5%, which is an FOCC, 50% foreign investment in Z is now owned by non-residents. And now Z has become foreign owned and controlled without any change in shareholding of Z, without any fresh issue of shares by Z. And Z also has 51% investment in MR Limited, which is a multi-brand retail business, and 60% in lottery business. So here we can see how Z became a foreign owned and controlled company from an Indian owned and controlled company without any change in its shareholding. Now, R, which is a FOCC, A, which is also Indian owned and controlled, suddenly their and becomes a foreign owned and controlled, suddenly their investment in Z becomes a downstream investment without any action taken by them. And Z, which was having investments in sectors which are having restricted foreign investment regime, such as lottery, in which foreign investment is prohibited, and retail, in which it is restricted. Z, now these valid investments of Z have suddenly become in breach of foreign investment regulations. So the questions which arise for our consideration are, which entity is responsible for filing form DI? Only P's shareholding has changed. Z's shareholding has not changed, A's shareholding, Q's shareholding, P's share. So even if the shareholding of A has not changed, R has not changed, still they have to file the form DI because the investment collectively has now become in a company which is foreign owned and controlled. Again, Z has to make form DI filing because investments by Z in MR Limited and L Limited have now become investments, downstream investments, because Z is foreign owned and controlled. Now the interesting questions which arise is Z liable for breach of foreign investments in MR and L? Is P liable for this breach? Is R and A liable for this breach? Now here only possible person who could have controlled or avoided this situation was P, if proper due diligence was done by the investors in P. But because of a failure by P, the breach has occurred at Z. The investments made by other entities, that is R, Q and A, are also now investments in a company which is foreign owned and controlled and violates the foreign investment regime. So maybe a more rational and thought through framework on reporting of downstream investments is necessary. We recommend that following actions be taken by a company to ensure that this situation does not arise for them. So before approving any share transfer, the investee company should check whether the transferor or transferee is an FOCC. Company should also cast an obligation on a shareholder to ensure that they do not become a FOCC without the consent of the company, as it can have serious impact on company business and also impact compliance obligations. It also makes it more important for parties in joint venture to ensure that there is an appropriate change of control clause with consent requirements for change, direct or indirect, in foreign ownership in case JV partner is in India. The reporting and pricing mechanism for downstream investment is also fairly complicated, and therefore we have played out various scenarios here, and after carefully examining in which situation you are falling, you can decide. So when a foreign owned and controlled company transfers its shares to a non-resident, the pricing guidelines do not apply, but the transfer needs to be reported in form FCTRS. When a foreign owned and controlled company transfer to the residents, pricing guidelines apply, but there is no need to make any RBI filing. When a transfer is from a foreign owned and controlled company to another foreign owned and controlled company, the pricing guidelines do not apply, but intimation has to be made by the purchasing FOCC to SIA, plus a form DI has to be filed with the RBI. Now again, when shares are issued from Indian company to FOCC, pricing guidelines are applicable, intimation to SIA should be made, plus form DI should be filed with the RBI. Again, issue of shares from FOCC to FOCC, while this is not expressly dealt with in the regulations, in our interpretation, pricing guidelines will be applicable and intimation should be made to the SIA and form DA should be filed. And similarly, for the next few situations, we have evaluated and this is our thought. Another interesting FAQ we noted on RBI website was whether an Indian company, which is an FOCC, investing in instruments other than equity instruments of another Indian company will be treated as downstream investment. So RBI clarified, no. So the question is whether, if it is not treated as downstream investment, whether it can be made, not made, what is the conclusion? Is only downstream investment that is permitted or any investment that is permitted? Another interesting question is whether other rules such as indemnity, deferred consideration, optionality, etc., they apply in case of downstream investment route or they do not apply. Now in a snapshot, the pricing guidelines, as they always have been in case of a listed company, has to be worked out in accordance with the SEBI guidelines or the preferential allotment guidelines in case of an unlisted company has to be calculated by a chartered accountant or a merchant banker, which could be a fair value at the time of the transaction. And if the Indian person is the seller, then in that case, there is a floor price. The seller cannot sell at less than fair value. Whereas if it is a purchaser, the Indian party is a purchaser, then there is a cap price. So Indian party cannot pay more than the fair value. Pricing guidelines are not applicable if SEBI pricing regulations are complied with, or when investment is in form of subscription share by subscription to a memorandum of association, is not also applicable on sale of shares by a FPCI or on investment on a non-repatriation basis. Pricing of convertibles, it has a set of challenges. So we take this scenario where compulsorily convertible debentures were issued in July 2019, where investment environment was good and hence fair value was INR 100 at the date of issuance. The conversion is due in October 2020. Due to the COVID, the fair value in October is INR 40 at the time of conversion. However, the pricing rules for conversion state that conversion cannot be at a less than fair value at the time of issuance of the original instrument. And hence the investor will have to accept INR 100 as the fair value and cannot get the benefit of INR 40, which is the real fair value at the time of conversion. So we still need more flexible pricing of convertibles. The regime needs further liberalization. Another challenge is rules relating to deferred consideration and indemnity. So earlier, the entire consideration had to be paid upfront. Some time ago, there was a liberalization where in case of a secondary transaction, 25% of total consideration could be deferred for a period not exceeding 18 months from the date of the agreement. And such payment could be settled through an escrow agreement or an indemnity, which means it could be netted off against any claims by the parties. Also, like a deferred consideration, they had a counter indemnity, that which is also 25% of the consideration, and the maximum time is 18 months. And seller could indemnify, but only if the total consideration has been paid by the buyer to the seller. So the way it's drafted throws certain challenges, such as whether the deferred consideration and indemnity is applicable only for a transfer related situation, or can a party doing fresh issue also take benefit? Well, the answer is we only have equity shares which are fully paid. For partly paid, we have a clear scenario. And for warrants, we have a clear scenario. So the deferred consideration is clear. But for indemnity, there is no specific provision on what happens in case of a fresh issue. Also, in real terms, in any M&A transaction, the indemnity time limit is not as short as 18 months, and it usually is a much longer period of time. So can payments beyond this 18-month time cap be made as a contractual indemnity payment, or will an RBI approval has to be taken to make these payments if indemnity claims arise after the time limit? Also, what if the amount of indemnity claims exceed 25%? Will RBI approval be applicable or not applicable? Also, can indemnity only work through a deferred payment mechanism? Can full payment be made and still indemnity be seeked? Are these rules applicable for a transaction between a FOCC and a resident, a transaction between a FOCC and another FOCC, where the purchase price adjustment is allowed? So these are some of the issues, and since the regulator has done such a sea change, maybe some of these could have been addressed. Another challenge to structuring investments is that usually investors seek assured exit opportunity, especially the private equity investors. Earlier it was not at all allowed. Then there was some liberalization where assured exit was permitted, provided the investor accepted a lock-in of 1 year and the return was not a guaranteed return. The price was not fixed, only the fact that the exit will be given was agreed. Now, whether the exit can only be provided in secondary or only in primary is one question. Why it can only be provided in primary and why not in secondary transactions? Maybe government should consider and liberalize the regime even for a secondary transaction in case of a short return clause. Also, one interesting development that happened was, whilst assured return is not permitted, in the case of NTT Docomo versus Tata Sons, Tata Sons had undertaken contractually to Docomo to pay the certain minimum price to Docomo if there was a certain conditions were met and there was provided an exit. Now the exit, Docomo exercised its option to call upon Tatas to purchase their shares at the assured price, and the Tatas said, you cannot purchase your shares at the assured price as it is not permitted under the regulations. There was an arbitration and damages were awarded in the arbitration. RBI tried to stop payment of damages, stating that it is not permitted under the regulation, but it was held by the court that there is nothing in the foreign investment or FEMA which stops payments of damages, and the parties were able to make payment of damages. So this brings us to a very interesting question, that although under the regulation it may not be permitted, still parties may in their contract have an assured exit clause with an assured price, and if it is not honored, maybe damages could be a route to still claim them. Thank you. Now I will request my colleague Alok to take you through the reporting mechanism for the foreign investments transaction.
Thank you so much, Aarti, for the detailed presentation. Good evening, everyone. I will be covering the topic of reporting requirements under FDI. Before starting the topic, let's first understand how FDI reporting has evolved over a period of time. So initially, the FDI reporting was required to be made in a physical format, wherein the forms were prepared physically by the companies and filed with RBI through AD Bank. The e-forms were the physical forms were replaced by e-forms, and the e-forms had to be prepared by the company and filed with RBI on eBiz portal. Now, with effect from September 2018, the e-forms have been replaced by a web-based form called SMF, and which is required to be filed on firms portal provided by RBI. In this presentation, we will understand what is SMF and how it is required to be filed. Now, an SMF, SMF basically means a single master form. Now, SMF has subsumed all the existing reporting methods of foreign investment in India. The SMF has been launched with the objective of simplifying and rationalizing the reporting of foreign investment in India. The SMF has combined 9 different forms, to name a few: form FCGPR and FCTRS, which are filed for issue and reporting issue and transfer of shares; form LLP1 and LLP2, which are filed for reporting investment and divestment of foreign investment in LLP; form DI for reporting downstream investment or indirect foreign investment in a company, so on and so forth. Now, for reporting a transaction in SMF, an entity has to first create an entity muster and register a business user. So let us understand what is an entity muster and what is a business user. Now, entity muster is a platform wherein all Indian companies having foreign investment are required to provide details of their shareholding. Now, the shareholding has to be on a fully diluted basis and has to be reported irrespective of the fact whether the original investment has been reported or not. Now, to prepare an entity muster, an entity has to an authorized representative of an entity has to be first registered as an entity user. For this, and the entity is required to file an application on forms portal. The RBI will review and confirm the approve the application and register the authorized representative as entity user. Upon registration, the authorized person will have to create the entity muster of the company. The entity user is personally liable for all the information mentioned in the entity muster. Companies which fail to create entity muster will not be able to receive foreign investment and will be considered as FEMA non-compliant.
Let us now understand what is business user. Business user is a person who is an applicant who reports a transaction in a single master form. The process for registration of a business user is similar to that of entity user. The only difference here being, in case of a business user, the application is reviewed and approved by an authorized dealer bank. Now, at the time of creation of a business user, a company has to provide details of IFSC code of the AD bank. In case if there is any change in the branch or in the AD bank itself, then a company will have to create a new business user. Now, a question arises whether can one person be registered as an entity user and business user for multiple entities. Now, the question is, the answer is yes, but in that case, separate registrations will have to be obtained for each entity. Now, with this background, let us understand the filings which are to be made under SMF. In this presentation, I am covering two important filings. One is issue of shares and second is transfer of shares. Now, a company receiving foreign direct investment is required to allot shares within 60 days from the date of receipt of remittance. In case if the shares are not allotted, then the funds have to be refunded back within 15 days. If the company still proposes to allot shares after the expiry of 60 days, it will have to first obtain approval from RBI. For this, an application will have to be filed with RBI through the authorized dealer bank. Generally, RBI disposes of such application within 30 to 60 days. Now, once the shares are allotted, the same will have to be reported to RBI in form SMF in form FCGPR in SMF within 30 days from the date of allotment. Now, inform FCGPR details regarding the inward remittance, allottee, type of shares issue, etc. will have to be provided. The details filled in the entity muster is automatically prefilled in form FCGPR. Now, along with form FCGPR, a company is required to file these documents. Now, the important ones being a valuation report. Now, in case of rights issue, the pricing guidelines are not applicable. In that case, valuation report is not required to be provided. Such a company has to provide a declaration stating that the price at which shares are issued to non-resident shareholders is not at a price which is less than the price at which shares are issued to the resident shareholders. Also, for rights and bonus issue, acknowledgement letters of form FCGPR and FCTRS of the original investment have to be provided. Now, in case the original investment was made pursuant to allotment of shares, then acknowledgement of FCGPR will have to be provided. In case the original investment was pursuant to transfer of shares, acknowledgement of FCTRS will have to be provided. Now, sometimes the company do not have the copies of the acknowledgement letter, especially in case of old investment. In that case, the company can approach the AD banker through which the original investment was reported to RBI and get hold of the copy of the acknowledgement letter. Now, in case of capitalization of pre-incorporation expenses, copies of FIRC for remittance by overseas promoter for the pre-incorporation expenses and certificate from a statutory auditor verifying the pre-incorporation expenses will have to be provided. Now, in case of pre-incorporation expenses, the allotment and reporting will have to be made within 180 days from the date of incorporation of the company. Now, this was issue of shares. Let us discuss the transfer of reporting of transfer of shares. Now, a transfer of share is required to be reported in case if the transfer is between a person resident outside India and a person resident in India, or a transfer between a person resident outside India holding shares on repatriable basis and person resident outside India holding shares on non-repatriable basis. Now, such transfer will have to be reported within 60 days from A, transfer of shares, B, receipt of funds, or C, remittance of funds, whichever is earlier. Inform FCTRS in SMF. Inform FCTRS the details of the transferor, transferee, the company, and the shares to be transferred is required to be provided. Now, like FCGPR, the information mentioned in entity muster will be automatically prefilled in form FCTRS. Now, the responsibility of filing form FCTRS is on the transferor, transferee, resident in India, or the person resident outside India holding shares on non-repatriable basis. Along with form FCTRS, these documents are required to be filed. Now, some of them being consent letters of the parties, valuation certificate, non-resident declaration in the prescribed format, a shareholding pattern of the companies whose shares are being transferred, a KYC and remittance proof, acknowledgement of form FCGPR and FCTRS for the original shares which are proposed to be sold. Now, this is applicable in case the shares are held by the non-resident shareholder. Now, there is one new requirement which is required to be filed along with form FCTRS. This is the transfer agreement. Now, transfer agreement does not mean the share transfer deed executed between the parties for transfer. It refers to the agreement entered into the parties for transfer of the shares. Now, the parties might not be comfortable in sharing copies of transfer agreement because of confidentiality. In that case, extract of share or transfer agreement may be provided along with form FCTRS. Now, in case if there is no transfer agreement, ED Banker generally provides a format which has to be filled in by the parties, signed and submitted along with the form FCTRS. Now, let us see some practical issues in filing SMF. First is one filing at one point of time. Now, a company can file only one SMF at one point of time. Any subsequent SMF can be filed only if the previous SMF is either approved or rejected. Now, this can create a problem in case of a closing wherein allotment and transfers are happening simultaneously. Now, in such a case, what entities can do, they can prepare the documents well in advance and then it pass through with AD Bank for their prior approval. This can help avoid questions in future on the filings. Also, different filings have different reporting period. For example, allotment has 30 days and transfer has 60 days. So company can plan their filings accordingly. Now, second issue is no resubmission. Now, if the information provided in SMF is incomplete or incorrect, the SMF can be rejected by the ED Bank. Now, unlike previous filing mechanisms, there is no option of resubmission available for SMF. Now, in such a case, again, if the documents are pre-approved by the ED Bank, there is less likelihood of rejection of the form. The third issue is the date of submission. Now, in case if a revised SMF is filed pursuant to rejection of an SMF, then the date of filing of revised SMF will be taken as the date of reporting and not the date of the original filing of SMF. Now, this can potentially lead to delay in reporting. Now, in such a case, what companies can do, they can attach a clarification letter along with the revised SMF, providing reasons for such a delay. In case if the reasons are valid, then RBI may condone delay in reporting of SMF. Now, this was about SMF. Now, in addition to this, Indian companies which have received foreign direct investment are also required to report, submit an annual return on foreign assets and liabilities. This is also called as FLA return. Now, the FLA return has to be filed with RBI on or before July 15th every year. Now, in FLA return, details of share capital, profit and loss account, reserves and surplus, outstandings with related or unrelated foreign parties have to be provided. Now, the FLA return has to be prepared on the basis of annual accounts of the company. Now, if the annual accounts of the company are not ready or not audited, then the FLA return can be prepared on the basis of unaudited or the provisional accounts. And once the accounts are audited, and if there is revision figures, then a revised SMF can be filed. Now, let us see the mode of reporting of SMF. Now, the mode of reporting of SMF, the FLA return has also evolved over a period of time. Now, currently, with effect from June 2019, the SMF is required to be filed in a web-based form on a portal called Flare, which is provided by RBI. Now, for this, first, a company has to register itself on the Flare portal and make the necessary filing. The process of registration can take about a week's time. Now, non-filing of FLA return before the due date is treated as violation of FEMA and penalty clause may be invoked. Now, let us see some practical problems in people face while filing FLA returns. Now, reporting of share application money from non-resident investor. Now, in case if the non-resident investor is an existing shareholder of the company, then a share application money will have to be reported. However, in case if the non-resident shareholder is not an existing shareholder, then share application money is not required to be reported. Now, filing of FLA if non-resident shareholders have transferred their shares to residents. Now, if the transfer of shares from non-resident to residents has happened before the end of the financial year for which reporting is made, then no FLA return is not required to be filed. However, if the transfer has happened after the end of the financial year, that is after 31st March, then FLA return will have to be filed. Now, whether FLA return is required to be filed when shares are issued to non-residents on non-repatriable basis, well, issuance of shares to non-resident or non-repatriable basis is not current considered as foreign direct foreign investment, and in such case FLA return is not required to be filed. Now one more question is, when can an entity file FLA return beyond the due date prescribed? The answer is yes, but in that case prior approval of RBI will have to be obtained. Such an approval can be obtained by sending an email on a prescribed email ID which is provided by RBI. It is advisable for approval of such application that a physical follow up should be done with the Reserve Bank. So now let's see what are the penalties for contravention of FEMA. Now under FEMA, if the amount for if the amount for which contravention is made is quantifiable, then a penalty up to 3 times the sum involved is prescribed. Now if the amount is not quantifiable, then a penalty up to 2 lakh rupees is prescribed, and for continuing default a further penalty of ₹5,000 for every day is prescribed. Now we can see that the penalty under FEMA is on the higher side, and therefore the companies are provided with option of compounding. Now compounding is a process wherein the person or entities admit default, plead guilty, and seek redressal. Now for the purpose of compounding, an application will have to be made to RBI. Along with that application, details of the remittance and reporting made, details about the default, copies of chartered documents of the company, balance sheet of the company will have to be provided. In the application filed with the RBI, details of the default, reason for the default, and the prayer sought will have to be provided. The RBI, upon receipt of application, will review and confirm, will review the application and fix a date for personal hearing. Upon personal hearing, the RBI will pass an order for compounding. The order will be, the RBI has to pass the compounding order not less than within 180 days from the date of application. The sum specified in the compounding order has to be paid by way of demand draft in favor of RBI within 50 days from the date of order. Now, with effect from November 7, 2017, the concept of LSF has been introduced. Now, under this, in case of reporting delays, the person or entity responsible filing reports are liable to pay LSF. LSF is basically late submission fees. Now, for calculation of LSF, the following formula has been prescribed. First, in case the amount involved in reporting is up to 10 million, the late submission fee is 0.05%. Now, which is subject to maximum of 1 million or 300% of the amount involved, whichever is lower. In case the amount involved in reporting is more than 10 million, then late submission fee is 0.15%, which is subject to maximum of 10 million or 300% of the amount involved, whichever is lower. The percentage prescribed is for the period of 12 months, and it doubles for every 12 months. Now, the LSF is an additional option available for company for regularizing reporting delays. The applicants can opt either for payment of LSF or for compounding of offense. For minor reporting delays, it is always advisable an entity should opt for LSF, as compounding is a long drawn and cumbersome process and take up to 2 to 6 months. Now LSF, one important point to be noted is that LSF is applicable only in case of delayed reporting. If there is a default involving contravention of other provisions of FEMA, the defaulting entity has to opt for compounding. This was about FEMA reporting. Over to you, Ria.
Thank you for the very detailed presentation. And now we would be moving on to the questions. However, due to restraint of time, we would not be able to take all the questions, and some of the questions would be replied to via email by the panelists. So I would be asking the first question. Can LLP engaged in business of wholesale trading accept FDI?
LLP cannot get in the wholesale trading foreign investment, because foreign investment in LLP is only permitted if there are no performance linked conditions, and wholesale trading is a sector which has performance linked conditions. So LLPs cannot accept investments in that structure. They will have to set up maybe a separate subsidiary company or some other entity beneath, transfer their business to that company, and then accept investment. They'll have to do restructure.
Thank you for the answer. The next question is, has RBI provided any relaxations for delayed filings during lockdown?
I will take that question. The RBI has not prescribed any relaxation for delayed filings during this lockdown. However, we have spoken to certain AD banks and we are given to understand that RBI is currently not levying any late filing fees or asking for compounding for delayed filing made during this period.
Thank you. The next question is, if an NRI is situated in China, can he invest under non-repatriation route without approval?
Investment made by a non-resident Indian under a non-repatriation basis is considered as a domestic investment and not as a foreign direct investment. And in that case, there will be no approval required.
We would be moving on to the next question. What steps should be taken when there is delay in filing SMF due to some technical problems on FIRMS portal?
Okay. Now, in case if there is some technical point, technical problem at RBI's end, so what companies can do when they file the FLA with the SMF or any return with RBI, they should provide a letter providing the issue involved, the technical issue because of which they could not file, and should file along with the form.
Thank you for the answer. The next question is, if the shareholding of Indian and non-resident in the company is 50-50, will the company be treated as FOCC?
Yes, unless it is clearly Indian owned and controlled, that is more than 50% ownership is owned by resident Indian citizens, it will be treated as FOCC, and any downstream investment by such company will be subjected to the downstream investment regime.
The next question, does the press note 3 have any restriction on investments from Taiwan and Macau?
Macau is actually a part of China and is considered as a special administrative region of People's Republic of China. So for any investment from Macau would be categorized as Chinese investments and would be subject to government approval in that case. Now in case of Taiwan, given its unique political position, one cannot actually completely rule out the concerns around the possible requirement in that case. Having said that, as per the IIT website, if you see, the investment from Taiwan is shown separately. And news articles which we saw in print media, it was mentioned that one of the senior officials have clarified that the investment from Taiwan will be treated as they were previously and are excluded from the latest amendments. So it's a kind of a gray area. One will have to see what happens, maybe, because that's just a information which is there in the press reports also.
Thank you for the answer. The next question is whether the foreign investment will be classified as FDI or FPI based on the schedule under which the investment is being made?
No. The classification is purely based on percentage. So even if a FPI is making the investment, if it exceeds the 10% threshold, it is FDI, even if it is made under Schedule 2. And it is not pertaining to the schedule. It is qualified on the basis of the percentage.
Thank you for the answer. We'll be taking one more question. Whether foreign investment can be made based on the press note or FDI policy, or is it necessary to?
So I couldn't hear the question clearly, but as far as I can guess from what I could hear, is it compulsory for the press note to be coming through a FEMA amendment? Yes. So even if the government has issued a press note, but it is yet to be implemented under the NDI rules, then it has to be, the foreign investment has to wait for it to be coming as an amendment to the NDI rules.
Thank you for the answer. We have one more question. Whether exercise of existing call option by a Chinese investor would be impacted by the press note 3. Similarly, whether exercise of existing put option right by Chinese investor against an Indian investor would be impacted by the press note 3.
In case of a call option, the shares would be transferred to Chinese investor in this case, what I understand. In this case, the initial ownership is going to change hand to a citizen or an entity out of bordering country. So approval would be required in that case, in case of exercise of call option. Whereas in case of a put option, the shares are intended to be transferred by the Chinese investor to an Indian citizen or maybe any other investor not situated in the bordering countries. In this case, approval would not be required because the beneficial ownership does not vest upon the transfer to an entity or a citizen situated in.
Thank you for the answer. Who is to apply for government approval? The investor in case of fresh issuance of equity instruments, or the acquirer in case of transfer of instruments?
Let me take this one. So the protocol documents or the SOPs do not in general specify who should be the applicant. But in some past instances where investors have made application, the RBI has come back saying that the application should be made by the investee company. So we recommend that the application as far as possible be made by the investee company. And please undertake consents, no objections be also submitted by the relevant purchaser and seller in case of secondary transactions.
Thank you for the answer. This brings us to the end of our webinar. I would like to thank everyone for attending it. And a special thanks to all the panelists. Thank you.
Thank you.